I want comics to respect it.
Yeah.
If comics respect it, I'll say, okay, I'm cool.
Live from the Willie Nelson and Friends Museum Showcase in Nashville, Tennessee, it's Music is Funny. Musicians talking to comedians about music and comedy with your hosts, Raylan Nelson and Jonathan Bright.
So smoking, I'm so high, I keep talking, I'm drunk, but I'm still drinking too.
Hey everybody, welcome to Music is Funny. I'm Raylan Nelson.
And I'm Jonathan Bright from the Raylan Nelson Band.
We have shows coming up May 28th in Memphis, Tennessee, and June 26th in South Pittsburgh, Tennessee, and then July 23rd in Panama City, and then July 24th in Santa Rosa Beach. So come see us live.
Live gigs. They're back. So today we got a kind of a unicorn. He's actually a Nashville native.
Well, then I'm a unicorn too, because I'm a Nashville native.
Oh, we had two unicorns on. Born and raised in Nashville, which is a rarity nowadays.
Yeah, he started out doing hip-hop, but transitioned to stand-up just 3 years ago.
Yeah, and it's cool because it's cool listening to how he's built. He's promoted his own shows and built his way up to clubs and stuff. It's an interesting perspective after talking to guys that have done it for like 20 years and stuff.
Yeah, he's really hustling. He's recently become a legend from his videos about our neighborhoods here in Nashville.
Oh yeah, we get into that. It's hilarious. His videos are hysterical, especially if you're from Nashville.
Yeah, and he's selling out shows at Zany's almost weekly, working on his hour special.
Yeah, and he's actually a fireman.
Yeah, thanks for your service. Without further ado, a Sir Joshua Black. So you grew up in Nashville.
Yes.
Born and raised here.
That's it.
There's about six of us that have been born and raised here.
Yeah.
And what part? East Side?
North Nashville.
North.
By TSU.
Yeah.
Hadley Park, all
Ted
that good
Rhodes.
Shit. Yeah, that's it.
Yep.
Literally right there.
I went to TSU on
really?
A minority scholarship.
I was about to say, you get the minority scholarship. That's beautiful. Nice.
So I spent a lot of time over there.
Okay.
Well,
interracial dating, maybe?
No, not really.
You had a man going in or something?
You know what? I got married really young.
Like, oh, there
right
you
out
go.
Of high school.
Y'all still?
Nope. No, we've been divorced for 10 years now.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
I keep telling her she needs to go back to homecoming, though.
Oh, it's all, dude, it's a must.
Yeah.
It's so rich culturally. It's like the purity of Black Nashville at homecoming.
Yeah.
It's excellent.
Yeah, it was so cool. I liked going there.
I bet.
And
I
there
bet.
Were a few of my friends from high school that went, too, so it wasn't.
Yeah, I went, but I wasn't, like, enlisted.
Right.
I just lived close, and like, you know, the weed man was there, and the girls were there, and I was just like, yeah, let's just do it, you know.
it's a big part. We talk a lot about music and comedy
okay.
on this podcast.
Let's
so
do it. I love both.
To start with, what kind of music fan are you? Casual? You big time?
Oh, huge hip hop nut. I actually did rap before I did comedy. I was writing raps. I did it for like 6 years. I love rap. Love old rap.
Like what era? Like where did you, how far back do you go?
Well, I started listening to like Dipset, Cam'ron, 50 Cent era, Nelly, like when I was younger, the early 2000s.
Right.
When I started rapping, I was kind of like, let me hear who the greats are. So they were telling me Jay-Z. I'm like, I don't get this shit, you know. Then I went back and listened to Reasonable Doubt, his first album, and I was blown away. And then Nas' first album, Illmatic.
Yeah, Nas.
And I was like, oh my God, I didn't even know you could do this with words. Like, I didn't know words could even be that powerful. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So after that, I just dug into 90s hip hop. I mean, from fucking Wu-Tang. I mean, so it just became everything.
Yeah.
Outkast, of course, UGK, Pimp C. So just huge rap.
I found it kind of interesting because I was a generation before. I was the first rap. Lottie Dottie was the first rap track
Damn.
I ever heard.
Okay,
so that,
yeah.
We cover Lottie Dottie in our band.
Really? Nice.
So you go from that, the Beastie Boys,
Beautiful.
All that UTFO, the Fat Boys, all that stuff.
Yeah, man.
But I noticed, it was years back, but there was, you know, the group The Black Crowes come out.
Okay.
And they basically are throwback to the Rolling Stones.
Okay.
And I was wondering, and it never happened, I was like, who's going to be the first person in hip-hop that goes all the way back and breaks it down to those just tiny beats?
I know.
I think just something about hip-hop, it just keeps evolving. Nobody really looks back too far.
I know, man, but I don't... That scares me, though.
Yeah?
You know, because it's like, there's so much money in it now. It was a baby then, and you had to be getting known for just the art of it.
Right.
You almost had to do it.
And that's what was cool about those first bands. You start with Dougie Fresh, and then you got UTFO,
And it scares me
everybody
now.
Everybody that put something out sounded completely different, because
right.
they were just fucking making it up on the spot, and there wasn't anything to draw from.
And
you
it's
know?
Such a hustle now.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, it's almost like I have to get out of my situation, so I'm going to rap to do it, as opposed to loving rap. It's almost like I'm a screw rap to get my money, which you got to understand too. Hell, I mean, yeah, we're in capitalism. You got to get your money. But like the art form, it worries me. Like, you know, we're number one right now as far as the genres. It's the most, you know, relevant, most popping. But jazz fell off. Blues fell off. Like, it's possible.
Rock and roll fell off.
You see what I'm saying? Yeah. So it's like, it scares. Like, I hope we don't go there. But, you know, there's some people trying to keep it alive.
It's cyclical, though, because that's what happens. That's true, your man. Genre is cool when it starts. People figure out how to make some money off of it.
Yeah.
But eventually it just turns into all, I mean, there's, of course, people in the pockets doing
cool
shit.
Yeah.
But it just gets corrupted like that, and then everybody gets tired of it. Country music was like that, huge.
Yeah.
And people are backlashing against the bro country and all that.
Right.
So it gets,
how do y'all feel about it? I'm sure y'all hate that, right? The spring break country type shit.
I'm not a fan.
Yeah, it's not. Yeah. I mean, a lot of people like it.
Right.
I mean, I stand by, if you can create something out of nothing, it's art, and that's cool.
Yeah.
And somebody's going to appreciate it. Mm. But, you know, when it comes to country,
I'm mostly a fan of people that write their own words and sing their own songs.
Oh, yeah. So that's real hip-hop-esque. That's how hip-hop genre
because
is,
because you can believe whoever's singing it. It's like, all right, yes, this wasn't created in a boardroom. Even if you're singing about pickup trucks and shit.
Right.
If you're writing those words and it's you, I can get into that a little more.
I think that's the beauty of it, too. It tells that story. And it's like one of the working-class genres, too.
Yep.
You know what I mean? The coming from nothing, and everybody can relate to that.
Mm-hmm.
So it's good if it's real,
yeah,
as opposed to some rich bastard who just somebody else wrote the shit for him. You know what I mean?
Yeah, and it seems like all cool genres start out of some kind of struggle. You know what I mean?
I guess that's how good arts created.
Yeah, old school country. Yeah. All that shit was poor people.
Yeah,
doing, you know, something.
Trying to make it happen, dude.
Yeah,
that's excellent.
The trip.
Yeah,
and remember when 90s country, and I love 90s country so much, and when it came out, people were bitching about how it wasn't country.
Ooh.
And it's way more country.
It sounds like George Jones now compared to what's out.
Yeah.
Okay. So what were they saying that was the real country? Fucking 70s, 80s? What were they talking about?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
60s, 70s.
Once Garth Brooks hit, that's when everybody...
It got scary then.
Yeah, they were like, this is crossing over into pop. I mean, maybe a little before that, but that was the... And then he sold a gazillion records.
Exactly.
So, you know, you're done at that point, because the record labels are going to go, we need 45 more of these guys.
Yeah.
So the individuality, once one person gets huge like that, you're fucked.
Scary, yeah. Damn.
So you started out rapping.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I started out rapping, and then I got a job as a firefighter.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
I used to buy weed from a firefighter.
That's beautiful. Yeah. Anyway, I bet it was fire.
A long time ago. Yeah, Am I right? You go.
So, forgive me, folks. And then I was like, man, if I'm rapping about, like, life, but I feel like you could take it serious almost. Like, you could use it against me as a Metro employee. You know what I mean? So I was like, I don't know if I can pull this off. Like, you got to be super serious. And then we're over here talking, like, just being real at the end of the day. And I was like, man. So then I went to comedy I went to open mic for like a cheap date. And I was like, we can go to a comedy show. We went to like Bobby's Idol Hour. They had an open mic over there.
Yeah.
We went over there, and then I got up, took a couple shots, got up there. And then when I got off stage, somebody was like, well, how long have you been doing it? And I was like, oh, that's all I needed.
Yeah.
But then I've tricked them into thinking I've ever done this before. It was over. So then after that, I just said, you know what, I can do this instead. And if the fire department tries to get me in trouble, I'll just say I'm joking.
Yeah.
So I can express myself the same way, but it's a joke, so chill, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And then that became an obsession, a passion, and then I got to go up every night, as opposed to when I was rapping, it's like, you know, maybe once a year if I'm lucky.
Yeah.
Right.
You know what I mean? So I'm like, oh, yeah, I'm doing this.
I bet you're writing your ass off in the fire hall, too.
Oh, yeah. I try to stay away from it, honestly, the whole 3 years.
But not about it, just the time spent there. You got...
Yeah, man.
Downtime.
Yeah, it's been tough, because they're so, so conservative. And they're so, like, we clash a lot, to say the least. You know what I mean?
Right.
So I just ended up getting isolated. So you would ask most of them, until, like, recently, they didn't even know I did comedy at all. Like, I don't really speak at all. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It just gets annoying. We annoy each other at the end of the day.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And I have more of a free mind, and I don't even plan on being there that long.
Right.
That can be taken as disrespectful.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? But, you know, sometimes a dream is just misunderstood, so I just keep them to myself, you know? But anyway, it worked out for me. I stopped doing the rap, started doing comedy, and it started working because the rap wasn't working. But I also learned how to take thoughts, write them down, and articulate them while rapping for 6 years. So then it was comedy. I was like, okay, just get a punchline, and then there you go.
Yeah. And I'm sure the rhythmic part of it too, telling jokes, oh, you man. Know, how just to use pacing your voice. And all y'all that know, kind of yeah, stuff. Yeah.
How to be able to use your voice, the power of that, stage presence. And the main thing is communicating your thoughts. Because sometimes you'll have a song idea and you write it down and then you let somebody hear it or you hear it. It's like, that, it's not what I thought it was.
Yeah.
And that's just like comedy. You'll be like, oh, this is going to be hilarious. And you go out there and they're like, what the fuck is he talking about? So yeah. I almost had 6 years of experience in like writing before I could come over here and understand like what people want. You know what I mean? Yeah. So,
okay. So you started doing open mics.
Yeah.
Around here, right?
Yeah,
around
Nashville.
Town.
Yep.
And then did you start venturing out to other cities and other states?
Not at first.
What's the circuit like, the open mic night? I don't even know in Nashville.
Okay, so yeah.
Zanies.
So
what
3 years ago, I jumped in and realized soon that they had an open mic night every night, maybe two every night. I'm like, I could do this every night. And there's people that do it. I'm like, oh, and then there's civilians that come, well, as I call them, civilians that aren't comics. A lot of times you go to open mic and it's just comics. So then it's tough to even know if your shit's funny because we're so cynical and we've heard your shit already. So it's like, we're not laughing. You can't tell if it's good.
Oh, that's like playing in music in Nashville.
Yeah, I bet. So we're going around Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. And now I've gained a new family of comics who maybe joined a year before me or right with me. So now I have a whole group of friends, a whole new family, a whole new culture I never knew about.
Yeah.
And that's all my life was. You know what I mean? I would go to work, come home, and that's just it. That was just it
and
all day.
From the people we've talked to that have been doing it for 30 years, they're going to be your guys forever.
Oh, exactly.
You know?
Exactly.
So those bonds you form now last forever.
And you can kind of tell, I'm sure y'all know, like you can tell who's serious.
Yeah.
And somebody who's like doing it to get away from their wife or some shit.
Right.
Like you can tell somebody who's putting the blood, sweat, and tears in. And we're all getting better. You know, because you'll have the same joke and you haven't written in a while, then your friend will have a brand new 10 minutes. You're like, how the fuck? I'm tripping. So now, you know what I mean? So it's just keeping you sharp. So anyway, we're doing that, man, for a year straight. So then I was like, man, I want to be of help to this community. So I was like, man, I need to maybe start an open mic myself. But I was only a month in at this time.
Right.
I was like, will they even care? Like, I just kind of wanted to, like...
pretty big stones to do that in a
month
in. Yeah,
it is. And I'm like, who the fuck is this dude? They didn't know me. You know what I mean? Like, sometimes at open mic, they would go in the back with the cool kids. And I was like, I never took that step yet. I'm like, I don't want to go back there. So I finally was like, I did my own little open mic. It was called Poor House in the Gulch.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And it was every Wednesday. And then it was super cool. I like packed it out with civilians who just kind of knew me. So now the comics like, oh shit, so like a real spot. So now the respect kind of went up. I end up being a cool guy.
Yeah.
So now we're cool. So now I get to kind of hang with the cool kids.
Yeah.
And then that started doing well. And then it got me better because I'm hosting. Mm-hmm. And hosting kind of sucks. It's kind of hard because... I hate to get vulgar, but I call hosting like kind of getting it wet.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And then once it's wet, then everyone can have sex.
Right.
Yeah. But your job is to get it wet. You really can't, you know what I mean?
Yeah. You're the fluff
foreplay.
Girl.
Yeah. But you can't really tell your A jokes because it's like, it's raw, like she's dry. You know what I mean? Like you can't just go in there, bro. You know what I mean? So it taught me how to host and it got me better because I'm getting a guaranteed 5 minutes, you know, every week. So that was cool. And then I started doing my own shows. Cause I'm like, I wanted to do Zany so bad. I want to do Zany's. And Zany's like, get the fuck out of here. We don't know you. You know, the booker kind of would see me and like, ah, what the fuck? I'm just some new guy. Well, and my jokes were probably trash too. You know what I mean? Realistically, right. If you think about it, 2 months in, oh, it was cringy even think about what I was talking about.
do you remember the first joke you wrote? Or one
it was
of
bad.
Them?
I remember I went to Bobby's that first night and it was this like real racist guy who got up there. Of course, I mean, he was in his element.
Right.
So,
right.
You know, so he's telling this joke, and I was the only black person there. And he said something about, like, Michelle Obama. And I was just like, I had to take it personal because I was the only black person in
right.
there. I don't even like the Obamas. You know what I mean? But I was just like, I got it. Like, it feels weird. You know what I mean? So I'm like, I got to get him. So, like, the next week I came back. I've written some whole shit for him. And it was like, this is super, like, aggressive. Like, you can't touch race shit with no experience in comedy. It's going to be heavy-handed, insane. And that's what it was. It was horrible. And the guy wasn't even there. You know what I mean? So now I'm like everyone's catching strays in the crowd. I'm like, oh, I'm so cringy. So and it wasn't good. I don't even know what it was. Something about it's probably a horrible gentrification joke about drugs. But it was bad. Yeah. So anyway, I wanted to do my own shows. So then I started throwing my own, maybe a year out. I said, I think I'm ready, like to book my own shows. And then also I can get some leverage. If I throw my shows, maybe another comedian will book me.
Yeah.
You know, so I did it at the Back Corner in Germantown. I don't know if it's still here. It was a nice venue. And for some reason, she only charged me like $100. I heard like
other... So when you do that, you bring your own PA, you take care of it. They just give you the spot to
They just said, hey, you get 2 hours for $100. And I, you know, completely just sold it on a lie. Like, there's like NashvilleStandup.com where you can go to all the open mics. I'm like, hi, I'm Joshua Black of NashvilleStandup.com. We have all these shows in town. I've done Zanies. I've done, you know, Bridgestone. You know what I mean? I'm doing this whole bullshit. So she's like, oh, yeah, hell yeah, Kyle, we've never done comedy. I'm like, I'm your guy. Trust me. They all love me. We'll do it. So we do that. And then, but the key was like, I've never done a show in my life. Like, how do I get people out? Because family and friends don't come to shows, really.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Oh, we'll talk, but now they do. But I guess we'll get there. But so I just went on Instagram and did like, I had a funny clip of all the comics doing something funny, saying something funny. And I ran that on Instagram. I maybe spent maybe $50 on maybe 3 weeks of advertising. And then we got to the show, maybe 70 people came.
Nice.
Which was pretty good.
Yeah.
And it was like $15 a ticket. So I got to pay the comics, got to take home a little something. And it went well, you know. And then after that, I kind of got my respect up. I started getting booked for shows. Then I went big. I was like, you know what? Now I'm the man. I can do whatever the fuck I want. I'm going to book a bigger comic, and then I'm going to open for them. That way I can sneak in and do 20, and on my resume I can say I opened for this person. So I emailed like hella comics that were huge, like Mark Norman. Yeah. I emailed like Joe, every comic that had, in that level at least. Yeah. Like mm-hmm. I went from like, I think if you had like 100,000 on Instagram or Twitter, I'm like, I'm going to hit you up.
Yeah.
And then I found a rate. I was like, man, I ain't gonna say the rate, but I was like, I got a rate that's affordable for me at the time.
Yeah.
And finally, I got Bonnie McFarlane.
Yeah.
She said, I'd love to come. And I'm like, oh shit. Well, I gave her something. She was like, give me a little more and I'm coming. And I'm like, all right, fuck it. So she comes down and I book it at the back corner again. And but this time it was easy to promote because it's her.
Right.
I don't have to promote myself at all.
Which is always hard to do.
Yeah, I'm like, it's a woman, first of all. So it's a woman comic. You get to see a woman comic. And then also, she's hilarious. I'm posting clips. They're coming. Spent the same on Instagram, $50. And then I think we end up maybe getting 90 to 100 people for the fee. I was still under 300 at the end of the night, but I'm like, I got Bonnie McFarlane here.
Yeah.
So I'll pay $300 to open for Bonnie McFarlane.
Yeah, totally.
Then she gets stuck in the elevator at her hotel because I had to get a hotel. She goes to a five-star hotel. Five-star hotel, bro. We get to
One? Let's call it out. Which one in town?
Well, they took care of her, so we can call it out now. The Hutton Hotel.
Okay.
I mean, very nice, but for some reason, she just got fucked over. She was just in there, and she emailed me after the show because she hung out for a while. She's like, hey, I got stuck in the hotel, and they're reimbursing the room, and the room was $300. So I ended up getting flat.
Oh,
you know what I mean? So I flatted out. So I was like, oh, you gave me time, and you gave me a free room. Like, thanks for your time. And then she didn't think that was funny, so she didn't email back. I'm like, oh, damn it, I bombed in front of Bonnie. But no, so anyway, that ended up being cool. And I was like, that's not worth it, really. Yeah, because it took a lot to get to zero. So I'm like, that's cool. And she was great. Now I have a new contact. And she told me, whenever I come to New York, whatever.
Yeah.
That could have been bull, but maybe it's not. But you know what I mean? Whatever. Yeah. You never know. I know she was really surprised I actually paid her.
She seems cool.
She's really cool. Yeah. But it's such a sketchy thing for some random dude who's been doing comedy mm-hmm. for 6 months.
We've done house parties like that. We're like, he sounds like he's good for it.
That's literally what it was. That's a lot of money. We'll go. Yeah, and I heard her podcast before. She had a weekly podcast with Rich Vaughn. Rich Vaughn.
Yeah.
So, and he was like, have you ever heard this guy before? And she was like, no. He's like, you think he's going to pay you? She's like, I hope so. So he was like, it's super like, she was like, what the fuck is this? And I remember before she got there, she was like, you're still going to pay me, right? I'm like, yeah. She's like, all right. I'm like, what the fuck ever. So then, like, it was legit. So that was cool. But then, like I said, I realized, I can't do that. That's not worth it. It took a lot to get to zero.
Probably at that point, you're like, I just want to do some fucking stand-up comedy.
Yeah. You know, I'm like, I love getting the it felt good. Like, I did this.
Yeah.
I brought her here. I brought all these people here. No one knew about this venue but me. It felt special, but I'm like.
But in the end, you're not a promoter. You're.
Right.
An artist yourself.
Exactly. So I'm like, man. And it's just, if I would have made maybe 500 or at least 100, I might have said, I'm going to keep this going.
Yeah.
I'm like, I can't do it. And I couldn't get any cheaper. This was pre-COVID. You know, you do it during COVID, they'll take it all day.
Yeah.
But like pre-COVID, it's like, I can't get any cheaper for anyone that you wouldn't know anybody if I got cheaper than that. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So then I was like, this is not going to work. So then I started just throwing showcases, and I was like, maybe if I theme it, I can sell it. Because it's hard. We have a great comedy scene, but you don't know mm-hmm. them unless we open for somebody.
Right.
And then they're like, oh, that guy was great. Who was that to open for Mark Maron? Or who was that to open for Joe List? And you're like, oh, that guy's funny, but you don't really know us. We're kind of underground scene.
And people wonder why bands and comics were like, you went and played for free to open up for somebody. It's like,
yeah, you kidding me? Exposure, dude.
Yeah. Now, the worst gigs are the promoter telling you about exposure. You can get great exposure. Yeah. You can get fucked on that. But there's certain gigs that are
absolutely,
like that,
man. Sometimes the money's it's not the big deal you're going for.
Yeah.
Sometimes the exposure is bigger than. Yeah, for sure. So I was like, maybe I can theme it. So then, and this is still me because I can't get Zanies. I can't get booked, really. I mean, I'm getting booked on our showcases, but I'm not going out of town. I don't really have a reel yet. I'm not going to wait on Zanies. And right. I also had this chip on my shoulder, like, I'm not kissing ass.
Yeah.
Because sometimes, you know, a booker comes over with the power and I see all the comics kissing ass. That's just part of the game. Mm-hmm. And maybe they're not kissing ass. Maybe they really like the booker. But I just had to be like, man, fuck out of here. I didn't like that. I was like, man, you're going to fuck with me because I'm good or because there's leverage here.
Mm-hmm.
So I never did that, you know. So now I'm like, okay, maybe if I do a show off of fucking a theme. So I did a roast battle. I'm like, oh, people love a good roast battle. And I can sell that. So I started marketing that on Instagram. And it was like, hey, fuck you, Josh Black, when I get to the show. I mean, it was like some wrestling shit. You know what I mean?
Hell yeah.
But it felt good because you've never seen, like, who's these crazy people? And you know what I mean? We ended up getting 75, 80 people to that. That went well. And that was really fun. Then I did another theme. That's What She Said, which is all women comics. So the themes started working. And now I'm picking up. So I'm like, dude, this is working. I got some. I'm going to start doing this in every city. Yeah. In America, at least in the South.
Right.
I'm gonna go Chad, I'm gonna go Atlanta, and then that's gonna be my way to the top. I'm going like the detour route as opposed to the Zany's book, you know.
Yeah.
So now I go to Atlanta. I'm like, I hope this shit works. I know no one in Atlanta, but I know a few comics, so I hit them on Facebook. Hey, you mind doing the show? That'd be great. How much money? I'm like, hopefully 75. Yeah, I mean, I don't know. Like, I have no idea. And they're also kind of like, what the fuck? Why don't you know? And I'm like, I don't know. Let's just see. So I convinced them to come out and with my Facebook and Instagram ads, same thing I did, playing clips of them saying, come, it's only $10, $15 at the door. I mean, that's a cool little date if you really think about it. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
It's comedy, $10. The clip is funny. What do you got to lose? So they come. It ended up being 80 people there. So I was like, oh, fuck. So now after I got to pay the comics, they respect me now. I can get booked in Atlanta because of that. And now I'm like, oh, it's over. Because if I can do this in Atlanta and I know no one off of just Facebook and Instagram, I'm going to take over the fucking country in a second. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So then I'm like, okay, I'm going to take over. So I book a venue in Charlotte. I book a venue in Chattanooga and Knoxville. And then COVID happens. You know what I mean? So I'm like, fuck me. And then I'm like, I don't know what to do. And you think, of course, you know, when it first happens, like, it'll be 2 weeks.
Oh, yeah. I said that for 6 months. Like, yeah, it's another couple weeks.
Yeah, it'll be a month. Yeah. And then it looks like it's hopeless. So I'm like, actually, it's fucking over, dude. It's over. So I just started getting into firefighting real heavy because my creativeness just couldn't stop. I couldn't turn it down.
Right.
So now I'm like being super firefighter of the year. And I'm like, and the firefighter's like, where the fuck did this guy come from? We didn't know he like this. I'm like, yeah, let's fight another one. Let's save some lives and shit. And then that kind of died out because it just wasn't real. I didn't have the results. Even if I fight a fire, I don't give a fuck at the end of the day. I mean, it's cool, but it's not like I don't live for this.
Right.
Yeah, and no passion there.
Yeah, and a lot of them, their grandfathers were firefighters. Their dads were firefighters. My granddad was a firefighter too, but there was a generational gap.
Yeah.
So he didn't just take me to work.
Right.
You know what I mean? If it was my dad, I might have saw it a lot. My granddad is kind of like a little gap. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I saw it, but it wasn't like, eh. So I was like, whatever. So then COVID hits. I'm like, fuck it. So then things started opening up a little, but not much. You would open up a little and then shut right back down.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
So I was like, man, let's just try some videos then. Let's just see if I can do like, because I don't want to get garbage. I started thinking, I'm going to be horrible by the time this comes back out. You know what I mean? Because comedy, you got to keep it going.
Exercise that muscle.
Yeah. And it's not like, I feel like music might have been a little easier because you can at least email someone a song and they'll say this is dope.
Right.
You know what I mean? Or you can hear it yourself and know it's dope.
Well, we've talked about this, that you guys... you know this from writing music. You kind of write your song and then you can go out and play it.
Yeah.
You guys basically put it in terms, you have a verse and a part of a chorus and you stand up in front of people and start writing that shit in front of people, you know? Yeah.
And they decide if it's good.
Yeah.
Like we can't decide that.
No.
You know what I mean? Because we will decide it's good and then they won't. Then you have to also cipher through, are they just annoying? Are they tired? You know what I mean? Did the booker book me way too late? And now they just like fuck everybody. You know what I mean? Yeah. Is it a weird town? Is it a racist town?
Did they zone out? Did they really not hear it?
Yeah, it's like, yeah. Exactly. Did I pronunciate it wrong? Exactly. So it gets tough, but you need that to figure out if the joke is good. So without the crowd, it's like we can't even write, even if we wanted to.
Yeah.
You can write an hour worth of shit during Corona, but you can come back out and only 2 minutes work.
Yeah, you got to try it out.
So I started doing what I call sit down comedy. Mm-hmm. And I just sit down at a table, like we're at now, and just I was talking shit. And I did it, and then at first they were like 20. I was like, this is going to be my new podcast. I put it on Instagram, and nothing really. I was like, okay. So I shortened it. Like, maybe we can shorten it a little bit. Got a few laughs, but it was still nothing. And then one day on Twitter, people were saying something about, it's Madison, East Nashville. And I saw it, like, get some, just on my little timeline. I was like, that's kind of interesting. I don't think it is, but I saw people going back and forth. So I'm like, let's do one about that. I do a video about Madison, and it goes from, like, maybe 600 views on mine to, like, 40,000.
Boom.
And I'm like,
I saw that one.
Okay, nice, hilarious. nice. I'm like, oh, fuck. All right. So next week, I'm like, let's try it again. Like, this time we'll do, like, North Nashville. Because then I'm from North Nashville, so that's easy money. So I'll go to North Nashville. Boom, 30,000. I do Antioch. Boom. But it's all, like, local black shit, you know? Yeah. So I'm thinking, damn, maybe I'm just the local black guy. You know what I mean? Like, I got to hit my lane. You know what I mean? Like, yeah. I didn't think that was going to be that, but I got to hit it. It's working. So I'm like, fuck. So then I was like, man, I know white people, too. And I was like, I don't want to, like, I was getting scared because, like, what if I do something and then the black people are like, what the fuck you talking about? We don't know nothing about no, what the fuck is a DSA? Or, you know what I mean? What is a Doc Martin? You know what I mean? So I was like, I don't know. So then I was like, I'm going to do East Nashville. And I'm like, that's perfect for black and white.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I mean? Because it's such a mesh. So I was scribbling and scribbling and scribbling. I'm like, this might be the one. This will end me or it'll be crucial. You know, and then it ended up getting the biggest out of everyone. And then after that, it was just, I was like, oh, I got something.
Yeah, so, I actually had a few friends text me that one.
Nice. That's beautiful. So that one right there was like, black people were like, oh, shit. And then white people were like, oh, shit.
Yeah.
And then I also kept it real. And I was like, oh, that probably meant the most to me. Because it's tough to keep it real and then have everyone still fuck with it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So.
And cancel culture.
Oh, exactly.
Do you have any local backlash from any of that shit from anybody?
No, man. Knock on wood. I was really into politics as well, when I was, you know, the last 4 or 5 years. So I'm not, like, too blind of what's going on, too. Like, right. I was, like, deep into it. Like, I was, like, a deep communist, started a communist party the whole nine. Like, I've been to meetings. So I'm deep into, like, what's offensive and then what's funny. So I probably have and I'm black, too. So I can get away with a little more than a white comic can at this moment. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Just like a woman, maybe, could get away with or a gay guy. It's just kind of, we got a little easy. We can still get canceled, for sure. But, you know, white men got the target right now.
Well, we're taking over the white women, too. They got a good target on their back now, too. So we got some company now. I think you guys are more hated than us at this point.
Yeah, I think so.
Oh, well, yeah, Karen gave a bad rap. Yeah. You got to watch. Is it a Karen or is she real? You know? Yeah.
I picture Karen with short soccer mom hair, though. Blonde. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but
yeah, passing
she's
off
a chick.
Priest.
She's not a
hippie chick. She's not a rocking out.
That's true.
Yeah, she can be overweight as well.
Yeah.
You got to watch.
Just figure everybody will get their time in the sun eventually if you live long enough.
Yeah.
Spanx.
Yeah, for sure.
She gets drunk with her friends at comedy shows, apparently. That's what everybody says. The worst.
Oh, yeah.
Well, I guess hecklers.
Oh, yeah.
But how do you deal with hecklers?
It's tough, man. It's tough. Like you said, Nashville, we have a lot of bachelorette parties.
Yeah, group
and that's the worst.
White women is what they say. Yeah, a group of drunk white women is the absolute worst crowd.
Where did that come from, by the way? How did we become the bachelorette town?
You gotta wonder. I don't know if I can blame Megan Berry. Some mayor brought them here. I don't know who the fuck it was.
Well, Megan Berry was having fun in office too, so maybe that's what.
So that had to be intentional. We didn't accidentally become a big tourist town, you know what I mean, with the bachelorette. So anyway, it worked. And it's cool because it's like, damn, we got pretty girls in the building. And then, like, by the time the show starts, you're like, oh, this is going to be a problem. You know what I mean? Because it's not like the real heckle. Like, a real heckle is like, man, fuck out of here. Or like, that ain't funny. That's a heckle. And you can end him.
Right.
It's like, you're ugly or your mom's gay and your dad had sex with your dog. You know what I mean? Right. And it's like, oh, no, it got him. You know what I mean? And then he gets, like, humiliated. But the drunk woman doesn't understand that she's heckling. She's just talking just enough to where you can hear it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Yep.
And she's never been humiliated in her mind.
Right.
She's or the final
she's,
say
or she's
on
helping the show. So you're like, hey, so I went to the store the other day. Tell us about it. You know what I mean? It's like, okay, all right. So then I went to the store and I saw this girl. You did. You saw her. It's like, God damn it. Shut the fuck up. And then, you know, you go that route, then it's, oh, wow, me shut the fuck up? Right. Wow. You know what I mean? So that gets weird. So sometimes if I get I go to the comedy bar a lot, and they in the heart of downtown, it's a lot of tours. Sometimes you just got to ditch all your jokes, and it's just crowd work. You just have to go into the crowd because they don't give a fuck. They're drunk, and it's just like.
A lot of material sitting out there for you, too.
Yeah. So, but it's rowdy, man. It's like a bull. And it's like if if you bomb in that, it's over for you. You might as well go ahead and bail.
Yeah, if you get overtaken by a crowd,
and they
done.
Have confidence now. It's like, you know what I mean? Because they don't understand that they're being an asshole.
Right.
That's the sucky part. You know
what
I mean?
Yeah.
It's like somebody just bullying you. They don't think it's okay. It's like, no, you're ruining a show. A lot of comics have an analogy to where, like, you don't go to Hamilton and, like, man, do that skit again. You know what I mean? It's like,
right.
It's a show. I prepared for you. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But, yeah.
Well, I think a lot of people are like I was way back, that you don't understand that a comic is not just up there
fucking around.
Yeah. They're tough. Like beats and everything's planned out, you know, yeah. to a certain extent.
Absolutely.
And
dude.
I think most people just think, oh, this guy's fucking funny. Let's just go sit back.
I saw somebody say that last night. That's one of the only genres people really think I could really do that for real right now.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, I don't want
He's
to.
Just
but I
talking.
Could. Because, I mean, and I think it's because they've probably made someone laugh before.
Yeah.
So it's like
everybody's
you know
had
I mean?
That
yeah,
experience
so like,
at least once.
Yeah, so
you're
talking to your friends and they're laughing. You're like, see, I could take that on stage, but I ain't even going. I don't want to do it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I'm gonna let them have it. So that they yeah. So that's weird.
Well, and then also that's what 5 seconds on stage that joke. You know?
Oh
and then,
my
and
god!
And then what are you gonna do?
You don't understand how slow time goes up
yeah.
there. Oh, it's
do
weird.
You time out when you have, or you probably have more than 5 minutes now? But mm-hmm. in that time, would you sit at home with a timer and time out a 5 minute?
You can, or a lot of times when you go to open mics, you'll have 5 minutes. So you know when you get the light, you're at 4.
Okay.
And you know what I mean? So you would almost write, when I'm in the open mics, I was writing in that 5 minute slot because that's all the time I had. I was just like, okay, I'll hit it there, hit a call back here, get a bet. But then when you get booked more, you do a lot of 15 minute sets. Now you can expand your joke writing a little bit. So now you can take your time with it. I found myself like rushing to get it all in that little 5 minutes because that's all the time I had.
We've done the same thing as a band opening. Like when we played Farm Aid, we had like 15 minutes and we just crammed as much shit as we could. And if you had, you know, to your point, 30 minutes, you can stretch out.
Exactly. And then I realized when I started doing time that I can relax.
Mm-hmm.
And I can fuck with the crowd for a second, or I can talk about this, or I can take my time with the joke, or I can do a long callback, or you know what I mean? Because when you got those 5 minutes, so to answer your question, I guess, yeah. And then you realize what works, and then you kind of add it to like your backpack. Say, okay, I got 5 minutes. That works for sure. Boom. You start on your next one. You write 5 minutes, and only 2 minutes are funny. So you take the three out. You do that two again, add another three. Now 3 minutes is funny. You know what I mean? You just keep chipping. Well, that's what I do anyway.
That makes
sense. You just
sense.
Keep chipping. You just keep adding on, and then hopefully connected, and then there you go.
Yeah. I bet there's a few poor souls that get that light, or waiting for the 4 minute light, and they hit their time at about 2 minutes, and like, where's the light?
Where's the light?
And it just burns straight through.
Oh yeah, dude, you'll hear that so many times. Somebody's bombing. So, have y'all got the light yet? Okay, no light. Yeah. It's like, no, you still got 5 minutes left. You just said
what's
hello.
It like bombing? You had to bomb starting off.
Oh, it gets fun.
After, you know, I mean, think it's all a reaction.
Yeah, it sucks, you know, at first, and it's like, especially when you think something's going to murder. Like, I'm thinking, this is going to get an applause break. They're going to all suck me off after the show. And then you get up there, and I'm like, what is he talking about? And I'm like, fuck. But then afterwards, you know, because something, or like, it's better when you bomb with a joke you know is funny. I'll say that. Like, if I've killed everywhere, and then I go to some spot, and it's like, they're not laughing. I'm like, okay, it's clearly off.
Yeah,
background. So fuck you. So now we can just do whatever the hell, you know. But you get numb to it. That's a good way to know what the fuck's going on.
Yeah.
But you don't want to bomb too much in a row. That's when it starts messing with you.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Imagine.
It's like, you bomb a couple times, like but after three, you're like, I don't think I should be doing that. I suck. I have to suck. Why would these people know what's good? And then, like, what happened is you'll bomb, and then the guy goes after you, murders. And you're like, ah, shit, it's clearly me. You know
and
what
you're
I mean?
Looking at him going, he's not that funny. They love this guy.
You take his mic from him. I'm funnier, man.
I'm hosting this show.
That sucks. But, you know, it's up and down, man. It's up and down. It sucked. My first time at Zane's, I bombed 3 times in a row before that show, and I was freaking out.
I bet number 4 was a stressor. Going
that?
In after bombing 3 times in a row.
Oh, no, so
back
number 4
number
was my first show at Zany's.
Oh.
So I was like, what the? I was freaking
So you're coming
out.
Off of 3 bombs for the first big show.
Because after COVID, like, we went from like 20 open mics a week to 3.
Yeah, you're just out of shape.
And then it's one guy who has open mic, I don't even like him, so I can't go to that, so that's like 2. And I'm like, fuck me. And I did those two, bombed, and it was new shit. So I'm like, but I was like, I think it worked. So I had to almost trust myself. I'm like, I'm doing this for Zany's. It bombed twice. Is it them or is it me? And I'm like, I just got to do it. And I also was scared because, like, all these people love me because of my videos. They don't know my stand-up.
Yeah.
So if I come up and they see my stand-up and it's trash, they'll say, oh, I'm just going to watch your videos. Why would I pay to come see you? You know what I mean?
Give me the 2 minutes and then,
yeah. So I'm like, fuck. So I was getting so much pressure.
I didn't think about that angle. That is a rough thing, like drawing a big crowd from snippets.
So the sellout started getting scary.
Yeah.
It went from like, I sold out to, oh man, this could end it. Like, one bomb. And then also, if you bomb up top, then it's going to suck for the most. You know what I mean? Like,
I'm
trying to get the girl wet and she's turned off and then I'm trying to have sex. That sex is going to suck.
Like, well, and then also coming from the perspective, my perspective of, I was already a fan.
Uh-huh.
So I knew I would like the show. You know what I mean?
That's true. That's true.
Because I had already, once I saw the East Nashville one, then I'm like, oh, this guy's funny. And I started watching
but
all the
other
ones.
The show because he was funny. Like, if you're
but
not.
But I already knew he was funny, right?
Right,
and
right.
I was already a fan before I showed up to the show.
That's true.
You know what I mean?
That's true. But as a
talent, though, you could see where somebody could be funny and you go, he's going to be hilarious. And you've seen like 2 little minutes.
Man,
and then you go there and he talks for 10, you're like,
no,
he
and
was funny
as
online.
A comic, I know that those are two different art forms.
Right.
So you might
not. You're a smart guy because I think a lot of people don't.
Oh my God.
I've heard of a bunch of YouTubers and stuff getting out, and people are like,
it's two completely. I mean, like, you'll have the best stand up guy who has an hour worth of all murder whose content is just it's horrible.
Right.
That's a whole different thing. And it's much easier, though. So you'd rather be the stand up guy. You know, because the content guy can edit.
Yeah.
You can't edit on your own stage. You know what I mean? Yeah. And there's no hecklers. You know what I mean? There's no crowd way. You get to control it. So that's two different art forms. Most people that are funny on like online aren't good on stage. I'd say 90%.
The art is in the editing.
Yeah,
honestly.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So I've noticed now that the editing is humor itself.
Uh-huh.
You know what I mean? Like, you can cut something and make the cut is funny.
Uh-huh.
You know what I mean? So, like, that's a whole other thing. So I was thinking, damn. And I do this stand-up, but they don't, like, it could get weird, you know what I mean? So, anyway, it ended up working. I remembered it all. It worked. I was, like, doing, like, some, I forgot what I said, something, East Nashville. I saw some, a hood black dude ordering, some kind of gluten-free option at a restaurant. And I'm like, East Nashville's gone, you know what
right.
I mean? Then I was just, like, so I just did the, and it worked, and then, boom, it was good. So,
yeah.
So, yeah, it ended up going full circle. So Zany's, I guess, to come back to my original point of not getting booked, I learned once I started getting the leverage of followers, likes, and I'm knowing, like, one of the most powerful things about it is that people send it off,
mm-hmm.
which is such a beautiful thing. You send to your girlfriend, you send to your friend. A lot of people are sending it to the booker. Like, who's this guy? I got to see this guy. So, you know, I was like, man, eventually I got to come to her and, like, ask her. I was just scared because I'm like, I've asked a few times before. And it's like, fuck out of here, dude.
Really?
You know what I mean? It's just business. It's not personal, even though it hurts.
Like, same with music, too, by the way. You didn't go
right.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
It's Nashville. Nobody sent for you.
Yeah. Oh, exactly. Exactly. So, luckily, that started working and I used it. And then, boom. And then the first one sold out. And then I was like, okay, great, great, great. Then we did the second one. That one went well. And then it was still kind of nerve-wracking because I was like, I hated hosting the first time. Cause I felt like everybody else got to have the fun. So this second one that you came to,
yeah.
I ended up going to the back and finally doing like some 25 minutes. And like, but it was also my first time ever doing 25 minutes at Zany's.
Right.
So it's still weird. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So the guy before me is going up and I'm like in the bathroom. Like, what the fuck?
Oh, you know what I mean? Here we go.
Yeah. And it's weird for me also because I'm not used to being nervous. Like most comics tell you they're really anxious. I don't have that problem. I have no anxiety. I have super confidence. So when I get nervous about something, it starts giving me anxiety because it's not a usual feeling for me.
Like, why am I nervous?
Yeah, I'm nervous because it's going to be bad for real. You know what I mean? And then you go out there and it's just, you're back at it.
Yeah, and I bet from, I'm sure you get along with the staff and shit like that. Being a promoter.
Oh, right.
There's a cool staff there anyway, but having that knowledge of how to put on a fucking show.
You understand it.
You're not barking orders at people and give me this, get me that.
Talk some diva asshole, yeah. And that's, I think, throwing shows kind of gave me the... It gave me that to understand how hard it is.
Yeah, man.
And also not leaning on Zany's to get it booked either. You know what I mean? Like, don't lean on anyone.
Yeah, it's a very punk rock move with that. That's what happened in those days. Like, nobody would book this type of music.
Yeah.
So people started either finding a warehouse for a night or whatever and just like, fuck it, we'll make our...
Yeah.
If they won't let us do it,
yeah,
we'll just do it ourselves. And I think that's kind of what's happening now anyway, because you can do a lot yourself.
Yeah, I mean, that's what it's about. And it's just about, like, what can you offer someone?
Yeah.
That's just it. Unfortunately, it's got to the point where you don't even have to really be funny. That's why, like, a lot of YouTube guys will sell out Zany's all weekend. And he's like, how the fuck? That guy sucks. But he can fill the seats. What, Zany's going to say no?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So,
but can they come back the next year and fill the seats?
Right. Will those people come back?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Like, exactly.
People exposed, you know?
Yeah, so it's weird, man. So... That ended up working out, and yeah, it's and then I learned from that. So now the next show at Zany's is going to be a roast.
Oh, cool.
You know what I mean? So now I'm taking all of that and just pretty much bringing it full circle back. So we're going to do the That's What She Said show. I'm going to do all that theme shit and just bring it back and kind of.
Love it.
That's perfect. Yeah. You got the practice at it. You know how to do it now.
Oh, exactly. I could bring out 70 people when I didn't know anybody. I should know how to, now that I got a little leverage. Yeah, you know what
man.
I mean?
Yeah. Which is also another valuable thing about booking those shows, man. Yeah. Just knowing how it kind of works. Yeah. And, you know, yep. Like you said, just doing it yourself.
And it took a while, man. You had to learn.
Yeah, that stuff doesn't happen overnight. You have tell you're a hard worker because it's the same thing with a band.
Yeah.
You get some initial reaction and you think it's just going to do this, but it flattens out and does a lot of this.
That's
and
if a fact.
And you also you use what you can to build the myth in the beginning.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. That's absolutely a fact. You got to lead into that.
We had one song and then a couple of the snippets, and we're just stretching that shit out forever. Like, we got to get some stuff done, but look how great we are right now.
Yeah, absolutely, man. I learned like small things that I might have forgotten. Like, you can't book a show. I used to just book book diverse shows for the sake of diversity.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But then the show would suck. Because I just booked her because she's a woman. I booked her because she's an Indian. I booked him because he's half Hispanic, you know, and half gay or something. And now I'm like, the show sucked because it wasn't about funny.
Yeah.
So now it's like.
But your intention was good.
It was, but it was still naive because I was like, oh, you're doing surface level shit.
Mm-hmm.
The reality of it is you need to care about the show.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So if you want diversity, look for perspectives of funny people. So now I'm looking for a woman, but she has to be funny. I want to book a black person, but he has to be funny. I have to book a gay person.
Rule now.
Yeah, so now we have different perspectives that are funny. You're not just throwing a gay guy up there just because he's gay. It's kind of almost pandering. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I've learned that. So now when I'm here, I can give you so many different perspectives, and it's real, and it's still diverse, but it's like a real diversity. It's not like that, like, surface level.
Yeah, and talking to some of the longtime comics we've done just on this, they're real big on if you're funny, you know, from Kathleen Madigan to Doug Stanhope.
Yeah.
If you're funny, you're in with us.
Exactly.
We don't care who, where, why. Just be fun. And if you are, you're golden. You can be clean. You can be dirty, whatever. But if you're funny, you're part of the brotherhood or sisterhood or whatever.
That is the currency in comedy.
Yeah.
It's so weird, man. I've even met comics like headliners who won't speak to you until you go on stage. Because it's like, there's no point in me being cool with you, me being friends, and you get off stage and you suck, I have no respect for you.
And now we're like, break it off so early. Grand opening, grand closing.
Yeah, so it's been weird. I'm like, hey, how you doing? They're like, hey, good. And they're back in their phone. I'm like, oh, I'm a good, big fan. All right, that's really good. Then you go up and they come back off. Hey, good shit, man. What you need to do here? I was like, oh, fuck, you're a person.
Yep.
You know what I mean? But they're like, yeah, I didn't know if you're funny or not.
It's so just like opening for bands. Do you do that now?
What's that? Oh, well, I try not to. these people have been doing it for 10, 15 years. I'm a baby. I'm 3 years old.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So by the time I get to 15 and then some young fuck is trying to, hey, guy, I'm like, get the fuck out of here, dude. So I completely get that.
Yeah.
You putting in 15 years of work and you bit all that dust. And then, you know, I completely get it. Now if I see like new open micers and they'll ask me like, hey, man, so do you do the same jokes often? I'm like, oh, God. Yeah. And I'll try as much as I can.
Right.
But I try to give any advice I have, which ain't much, to somebody who I think is serious.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
What is that advice?
Persistence.
Quit comedy.
Yeah. Just quit. Yeah. Well, I'll just say just persistence, consistency, and then obsession. And if you don't want to be obsessed, there's no point. I mean, I get it, though. You got families, you got kids, you got grandma and the dog and all that, but if you can't be obsessed, it's going to be a waste of time because you're going to be half-assed and you get half-assed results.
Mm-hmm.
And that's
mm-hmm.
just it. I just learned, when you go hard, you get a decent amount of results back.
Yeah.
But if you go easy, you ain't getting shit.
But you also got to be prepared to go hard and not get shit back from time to time. And you have to be able to weather. That's where the obsession comes in. Because with music, it's the same thing.
Yeah. Or what happened is, if you're lucky, you'll get at least better.
Yeah.
That's some currency, too, for me. Like, when I first started, I was doing a show and then a comic will say, dude, you've gotten a lot better. That was enough. That was better than the paycheck.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I mean? So the paycheck was $25, but this comic I respect was like, you're getting better. I'm like, fuck. So now I get to go harder again. You know what I mean? So sometimes that's your only result for a while.
Yeah.
But it's worth something in comedy.
Well, that's also another theme that's rolled through all these comics that are very successful is all of them bust their ass.
Man.
Or have to build it up. Every last one of them in different ways.
Yeah.
Even Stanhope, who seems like just a big drunk running around, he was working. He lived for 2 years on the road. Didn't even have a house. Lived on the road. So
man.
Call it what you want. He's doing all kinds of podcasts, you know, to keep...
All work their ass off.
Yeah.
He plays it down, but, you know.
Man, I love that, dude. And I just love the grind. That's just, my personality, you know, I just, I like it, man. Especially when you see some shit from it.
Yeah, that's
like
the
I said,
best.
I did music for so long, got nothing. Once I, like, I can actually get some, like, oh, it's over. Like, once that first video did numbers, and I'm, so now I'm in a space where I'm trying to, like, slowly leak out of local, but keep it, because there's so much power I'm realizing in local, because, like, that's where all my fan base is. So if I'm trying to get sponsors, I'm trying to get anything, I can talk to a guy who's in, like, I can talk to a Hattie B's and say, hey, I have all your fans. We can make them, you know what I mean? As opposed to having a nationwide fan base, I might not be able to help a Hattie B's or, you know what I mean, a Princess
but
Chicken.
But even local, you've got, you know, like as a band, there's all kinds, of, for you to branch out from here, you know, within 10 hours, you can get damn near anywhere but Texas and California. You
exactly.
Can get it all
exactly.
By
but,
car.
But I bumped into some trouble. Like, once I did a few, you know, viral videos on local shit, I tried to, like, here's some relationship shit that everybody can, and they were like, we'll be all right. I'm like, fuck. So it's like, you know what I mean? It's almost like, nah, give me the hits. And I'm like, all right. So now I'm like slowly trying. I'm going to sneak them though. I'm definitely going to get away with it. But like, I just got to sneak into it. You know what I mean? Yeah.
That probably speaks to the difference between videos and stand up though. That,
oh, exactly.
You know, that shit would work on stage and they're like,
easy.
Nah, just get back to the local
stuff.
Yeah,
we like what we like. And I'm like, no, because then what'll happen is you'll be like, he's still doing this shit.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So it's like, they don't even know what they want almost. So I'm doing one tonight. Hopefully it'll work. It's about Tennessee as a whole.
Yeah.
So I'm gonna hit Nashville, I'm gonna hit Knoxville, I'm gonna hit Chattanooga, and then maybe I can start hitting Tennessee as a whole.
Yeah.
We do that, and then we just keep trying to slowly go.
Yeah, and then it'll be California.
Yeah,
New York,
exactly.
Texas.
And then you look up, and then boom, even though I know
that's your special.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, just the states.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Where would you film your special? Where are you going? When you film your special, mm-hmm. what would be the ideal spot to do it? Would it be? Of course, it'd probably be here, right?
I would. I mean, right now, I guess
at the
so.
Papa Willie Museum. I mean, no, I'm
yeah, yeah, yeah. We're gonna do it right here.
Right here.
We're gonna do it at Cooters. But like, they have Confederate flags in the ground.
There you go.
But yeah. So I don't know, man. I guess
I have a funny story about that. When we were interviewing Kathleen Madigan, we didn't do her.
Damn it.
I realized that my cats had peed on my shoes, so I threw them off and went over just tossed them over in the corner. I'm like, I gotta find some shoes, so I go over to Cooters to see if they have some, and they do, but they have the rebel flag on them.
That's the only flip flops I had. I'm
like,
you didn't buy them?
Only flip flops. I'm like, no, I'm not. There's no way I'm purchasing that.
Yeah, you gotta risk the whole brand to have some shoes. It's like, fuck.
So I went barefoot that day.
Oh, okay, yeah, anyway. that would have ended you right there. Willie's granddaughter now.
I know.
We can't have anybody.
They're $14 for some racist flip flops. Yeah. Like, no, I'm not doing this.
Oh, that's great.
Anyway,
that's great.
Back to the venue.
Yeah,
the
venue.
Oh, so I guess Nashville. I don't know.
Like
I'm still thing? Like that would be excellent.
Why?
I guess the options are limitless. I don't even know if I'm even in a space now. Even have that option, but like right now I'm working on the hour.
Yeah,
you know what I mean. So once I have the hour, and then I'll work the hour everywhere, then I'll probably be in a space to, unfortunately, just get rid of it.
Yeah,
you know what I mean. But it'll be great, you know. So I'm kind of working on it now, and then I'm gonna start dabbling in some clean as well.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I mean, not because I like it, just because it's a challenge.
Apparently it's pretty difficult.
Oh yeah, hell yeah, because life ain't clean. So now you gotta find it. That's why I was writing dirty, because life is, I'm writing life.
Yeah.
Life is dirty.
You know.
Plus most of the funny words are curse words.
Yeah, it's like when you get into a wreck or something,
funny.
Like you're not gonna say, oh shoot, you know what I mean?
And if you do, that's funny.
That is kind
of
funny.
Yeah. Yeah. That's the name of the special
that would
now.
Be Tom
oh shoot.
Papa.
Oh shoot.
Shucks. Rats.
Oh. Yeah, so yeah, I still want to sharpen some skills, because I don't want to like go back to my first album and be like, what was I doing? It sucked. That might be inevitable.
Yeah, you'll probably do that no matter how good it is.
I know.
Although, but again, the people we've talked to, you're like, yeah, a lot of it was bad, but there's a few things.
That's
that
what I'm saying.
Bad. There's a few
and
things.
Like, I just like, normally people don't start moving in comedy for about 10 years anyway.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm at a weird space. Like, I'm in 3 years and I'm trying to get some traction. I'm like, oh, what do you, I don't know. Like, if those guys who were like Stanhope did his first album in 3 years, it could have sucked.
Yeah.
Because he's probably still grinding, you know, the Bargatze's and shit. So I'm like, I don't know. So I'm kind of in a weird space. I want comics to respect it.
Yeah.
If comics respect it, I'll say, okay, I'm cool. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, good comics, you know, not just friends. Like, if they'll say, okay, this guy's funny, then I'll be okay with it.
Successful, other successful
comics.
Yeah,
just because I'm so early. If it was 10 years in, I wouldn't care, or 15 years. But I'm like, if the fans like it, I can still be hack.
Because yeah, it's true. Get your own tiny fan base.
Yeah, you can be popping and know the people in the art don't respect it. You don't want to be a a rapper and Jay-Z's like, ugh, turn that shit off.
That's true.
You know what I mean?
Right, right.
You know, so I'm like, as long as...
Unless you're making Vanilla Ice money, then maybe you can deal with that.
Yeah, but see, I don't... Exactly. Yeah. I hate that. I don't... Exactly. You'd be Vanilla Ice then.
Yeah.
So, no. Hell no. Hell no. Chocolate ice. But so, yeah, man. We'll see. I just need to work. And it's tough now. I'm juggling writing and...
Performing all the time?
Doing the videos.
Yeah.
That's the thing is you got to wait at least while you're building, the experience and all that shit 3 years and beyond. You've got things like the video stuff.
Yeah.
You figured out hustles all along the side that are all working that same muscle.
Oh, yeah. That comes from just being broke as fuck for so long.
I can dig it.
You finally get some leverage and like, oh, I'm going to milk this. And I'm still learning.
Yeah.
And I'm still thinking. I'm looking at other shit, man. And I'm like, I got to get this. I got to get that. But then you can get lost in it. And then it's time to do stand-up again, and you suck. So you got to kind of balance that. Because right now, we don't really have a viral guy that's also great at stand-up. That's like a new thing right now. If you're viral, a lot of times you suck. If you do stand-up, you're too stand-up-y to do it. So I'm trying to be that guy, and it's a tough balance. Mm-hmm. And also, I'm doing shows now every month here in Nashville. So I got to write quick. Because I know with black audiences, at least, they hate you repeating your jokes. They just they get it, and they just don't give a fuck.
Right.
That's the same shit you said last time.
Right.
I'm like, yeah, of course it is. You know what I mean? But it keeps you sharp, you know what I mean? So hopefully I'm going to come up with some more shit. I'm going to dive into some – I didn't want to talk about my job for a long time, but now I don't care. I feel like if they – because they've been trying to – well, people on the job have been trying to fuck me for quite a while.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like I said, they're super conservative. A lot of them work at Cooters on the side. And
wearing those flip-flops.
They made the flip-flops. So, yeah, like I did a prank phone call to, you ever been to, I guess I shouldn't say it. It's a hat store.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I did a prank phone call after Trump lost. And it wasn't even bad. There was no curse words. And I feel like the owner got her rocks off. You wouldn't listen to that if you were a Trump supporter and be like, no way. You might even be like, yeah, she told him. It wasn't bad at all. But one of the firefighters ended up calling the hat store saying, hey, this guy is this name. And this is where you can get him in trouble.
Oh, hell.
Got me suspended 10 days, the whole nine. Threatened to fire me, the whole shit.
That was the blowback I was talking about.
Yeah. So now I'm like, so then it just made me so resentful. Mm-hmm. To the whole shit. I'm like, you know what? If you ask me, I'm giving you good PR. You know what I mean? If you're like, what the fuck? One day you're going to have a picture of me and say, oh, this guy was on the fireman. You're going to use that to recruit motherfuckers.
Yeah.
Really? I don't really. So I was like, So I was kind of staying away from that because I'm like, y'all don't deserve to be even brought up in my shit because you know what I mean? And then that was a while ago. So now I think they kind of get it a little more and I'm going to start talking about just life as a fireman, a little, just because it's funny shit in there.
Yeah.
It's ugly shit in there, too, but yeah, I make it work. So I think that's what I'm trying to do.
And it's not too specific, as long as you don't say the exact department.
And I mean, soon I won't give a fuck.
Station number 37.
That's the goal, is to not worry about
that's
that
what
shit.
I mean, I'm close to not caring. Like, I mean, it's like, whatever, dude. I'm doing this, it's comedy. I literally changed my last name to stay away from y'all, and you still, I'm like, get the fuck out of here.
Yeah.
And at this point, people know it's a joke. So
you changed your last name?
Yeah.
What is your real last name?
My real last name is Lipscomb.
Oh.
So it was weird, and that's how a lot of people grew up knowing me. But realistically, it's kind of cringy because, I mean, I love my family, of course, and they made their own name. My granddad was a great guy. People love the Lipscombs, the black Lipscombs, whatever. But Lipscomb School is here.
Yeah.
And I can't help but to think of the reality of it. You know what I mean? That's the name because they owned slaves.
Right.
And then they just kept the name. So that was always weird to me anyway. And then I got in the fire department. I'm like, if I make a viral thing, I don't want Josh Lipscomb, and then they can try to tie it. So I was like, you know what? Let's just name it. I came up with so many horrible names. My first name, I was like so into black shit. My first name was Mansa Rashidi.
Damn. That sounds like it came with a costume.
So stupid. So that was my first name, and I was just like signing up for open mics with that on there. And they was trying to announce it. Hey, next up, it sounded so ridiculous. I'm like, that's just insane. I've been reading too much. I got to like get out of that. So then I was like, nah. And then I changed it to, I went to a Muslim phase. So then I was Josh Ali. And then I was like, it's cool.
Easier to say.
Yeah, it's easier. You know what I mean? So, you know, and I was like, and then I was just like, then I got out of the Muslim phase. I'm like, I don't want to be tied to Muslim shit if I don't, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So then I was like, I like black shit, so I'll just be Josh Black. You know what I mean? Like, and there it is, boom. And then it just worked. And then after that, it just clicked. And then I started doing open mics consistently, and they started calling me Josh Black. So I'm like, oh, this is it. I can't change it now.
Yeah.
So now I'm Josh Black.
And where did the sir come from?
Joshua Black was taken
on
Instagram.
So then, couldn't be missed, Joshua.
Yeah, I'm not an underscore ass motherfucker, man. I'm not gonna underscore my shit. Like, that's not creative to me. So I'm not gonna underscore me. You know what I mean? I'm gonna go ahead and throw the sir in there, and then it just worked. And I was watching Game of Thrones at the time. It might have had something to do with it. You know what I mean? So I put it on my Twitter, and then there it was, and it kind of just stuck.
Yeah. Nice.
Sir Joshua Black. Either that, or I've been knighted. I've officially been knighted. But yeah, man. So,
well, it sounds like you got it going on. Oh, before we get out of here,
I need to ask you. So, tell me about the first time or your own personal experience with Papa Willie, my grandpa. When you remember hearing about him, and if it's nothing, that's okay too. I'm just
No. I was
Well, when I DM'd you to ask you to be on the podcast, you said, "Well, I consider Willie to be my grandpa too, so we're cousins."
Yeah, that's what I realized. I didn't even know I had family that did podcasts. I'm like, that's crazy. I got to pull up. So it's insane. But when I think it was during when I was rapping, and I realized going back was helping me write.
Yeah.
Going back and like that was studying. So I started studying the greats of every genre except like rock. It was just too black to get it. Right. You know what I mean? So I was like the screaming, I didn't get it. So I would go back. I started listening to Bob Dylan. I started listening to the Beatles, and I would just Google best songwriters.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And then there was Willie, there was Bob Dylan, there was Paul Simon. You know, all these names I just kind of know.
Yeah.
And then I started going back into it, and I also had this like Nashville culture of country. If you don't really know a lot of the songwriters, for black people, it feels weird as fuck. Like the culture of a lot of the country fans, it kind of shies you away from it.
Oh, yeah.
So when you hear it even, it feels weird. Like, I shot away from country my whole life just because, like, most people I heard listening to country were assholes.
Yeah, right.
You know what I mean? So I'm like, fuck that. So I had to almost take that off and just listen to a songwriter. So I started listening to Redheaded Stranger or something. Yeah. Is that the album?
Good starting point, yeah.
Oh, murder, son. Because I'm a big discography guy.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So I found that, and I'm like, oh, this dude's a monster. And then, so I started taking that, and I just love how he told stories, and he's just like this lone guy. And I'm an only child, and I was writing, and my mom was traveling, so I just had the house to myself, and I was in North Nashville, and I had like maybe a couple friends, but I was just writing all day, smoking weed, writing. So that lone ranger attitude was just all me.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And then I was just smoking, and that's kind of how I was like, oh, this shit is crucial.
Yeah.
And then realizing that, then so him and Bob Dylan to me just like incredible poets. And it was almost like the experience I had with Jay-Z. Like, I didn't know you could do that. Mm-hmm. I didn't know you could paint that picture. And then also, he gave me respect for like rural Tennessee and just rural, because I'm a city guy. And like I said, when you pass through those towns, you see the Confederate flags flying, I'm like, fuck them.
Yeah.
But so you don't understand there's a richness to the land of Tennessee, the geography of Tennessee, the culture of it, outside of the surface of what I've seen.
Yeah.
There's something there that he kind of brought me into and was like, hey, this is like, it's like a movie, like old Western.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, oh, this movie's fire.
Right.
And he's not saying the N-word. You know what I mean? So like, I can watch it. You know what I mean? So yeah, him and Bob Dylan probably were huge inspirations on just creativity, writing, and then also just badass.
Not giving a fuck.
Did you know Charlie Pride? He's a country singer. He's a black country singer.
Okay.
He actually died of COVID, right?
Damn.
I think just recently, but the same class as Willie.
Really?
He was the first one multi-million selling artist.
So you haven't heard the story in the 60s. My grandpa kissed him on stage, on the lips.
Oh,
yeah,
damn.
In the heart of the Civil War. Civil rights movement. In the middle of the 60s.
Hold up. Ceasefire. I have to make out with this man.
Muskets down.
Continue. Yes.
No.
Oh, that's beautiful.
About 100 years after the Civil War, actually.
Yeah, anyway, Civil Rights Movement.
Civil Rights Movement.
That's beautiful.
Isn't that neat? Yeah.
That's beautiful. And you can tell, though, man. You can tell when you can feel somebody's spirit through their music, and you can understand if somebody's an asshole, if they're not. Well, for the most part, I can.
Mm-hmm.
It's rare that, like, somebody comes out and it's like, wow, he said that? I don't really ever feel that way.
Yeah.
It's like, yeah, I can feel it. You know what I mean? So, yeah, he's just badass. And also, like I said, a lot of times when you're working class and you're not an idiot, you kind of get that the people up top are fucking us all. You know what I mean?
I preach that every day.
Yeah, so you kind of understand it if you're not, like, so manipulated that you don't understand. Like, you know what I mean? A lot of rural towns, they're so manipulated and isolated that they can't get out of what's going on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, just want to go, look, they hate all of us.
Yeah. You know?
The people up there, like, they hate all of us.
But they're like, yeah, but I feel special. If I hate that guy, you know what I mean? If I hate this group, I get to feel like this country's mine, even if I'm broke as fuck.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? But that's an idiot. You know what I mean?
Of course, that's also the way of social media. find somebody to hate. I feel important in this. This country's mine.
Yeah, man.
Depending on who you hate, not who you like.
It's insane. So reality doesn't even matter.
Yeah, and I don't think most people, I think, don't really give a fuck about other people so much as they just want to be left alone.
Right, that's true.
Probably 85% of the world doesn't want to impose anything. Just like, don't fuck me up and let me do what I want to do as long as I'm not hurting anybody.
And also what probably, I don't know his story to that degree, but I would assume when you're that good of a songwriter, you're taking inspiration from everything. Mm-hmm. So if you're a racist, you can't even listen to no black music.
Yeah.
And it's so much fire.
It's true.
Yeah. You know what I mean? So when you probably, so if you're a writer and you're dope as fuck, and then you hear another writer that's black I feel like that kind of can kill it for you too. It's like this dude writing, I have to respect him on that alone. Because like I know I was doing the Picasso exhibit at the Frist, and I learned while studying it that he had learned some of his cubism from African art. And no one had any respect for African art, and that's what took him to the next level. You know what I mean? So it kind of like, he still did some.
He took the blues and made it bigger, basically.
Yeah, literally, man. So it's like, damn, so he could, like, the fact that, but the racism could blind you to that. Like, if you're being an asshole, now you missed out on hella inspiration. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I think sometimes when you're searching for greatness and you're good and you don't have, it's not smart to be racist. You know what I mean?
Yeah, so, I agree.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I think with our generation and the future ones, it's just going to be better because I feel like we're all taught equality, you know, in school. I mean, there was a picture of all the different colored hands holding hands.
Right.
Like unless you just had hate spewed to you from your family or environment, which I didn't. So I, you know.
Right. That's true. Yeah, if you're isolated, they have to isolate you. Because even if you get hate from your parents, you still go to school and be like, no, Jamal's cool. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's like, I just fucked Jamal. The dick is great. You know what I mean? So you can't, you're not your mom.
Plus, people have the internet now. It's hard to even isolate the rural people. They can branch out and
that's key.
They like Cardi B and their mom.
Right.
You know, going crazy. Some of them are having to hide that. And that's fun as a kid, hiding that shit. I used to do that with records anyway. So.
Yeah.
There's a whole, there'll probably be a backlash because a lot of people don't want to turn into their parents anyway. So.
Yeah. And it's cool to be for me, to get to know everybody.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I mean? Now, you know, as black people, you still need to know yourself because you have to, it's exhausting because you got to go find it. It's not taught. So now you have to get off work and fucking find out what the fuck black shit is, you know, because you're told you ain't shit or whatever.
Right.
So it gets exhausting. And I know a lot of my friends wouldn't go to like white parties or stuff like that because almost wasn't a real fear, but it was like, because I got suspended from so many schools growing up that I was around every race of people. I mean, I probably went to 12 schools.
Yeah.
Growing up. So white people were.
Did you go to Hunter's Lane High School?
Nah, I went to MLK High School.
Yeah.
Martin Luther King High School. And I left there because my mom got into it with the basketball coach. That wasn't my fault.
Yeah.
Everyone else was my fault.
My brother went there and got stabbed by some girl there.
Really?
Yeah.
That's good dick.
There you go.
That's what good dick. You gonna take away that dick?
He also stuck a paperclip in the outlet and
the
whole electricity shot.
When year did he graduate?
I don't know, but he's probably more around your age than I am. How old are you?
I'm 31.
Yeah, he's 30. So he.
I probably went to school with him for sure.
Jeremiah.
Remember the lights going out one day?
Jeremiah Major is his last name. He's my half brother, but we say.
Okay. Yeah. I'm sure I know him for sure. I left at 10th grade, then I went to Hillwood. I went to Hillwood. That's why I was zoned somehow. I went to Hillwood, then got kicked out of Hillwood selling weed. Bullshit. Wasn't even a lot of weed. I was the basketball captain of the team. I was like this guy, and I had a suit on when they got me because we had to wear suits for the game.
Yeah,
I had this big ass Steve Harvey suit on because that was the style. You just wear the big ass. Stupid as fuck. So I'm in this big ass fat tie, and I gave it to this white guy. And I said, "Hey man, I'm like I want to feel like a boss. I'm like you sell it, and then at the end of the day, you give me the money for it, and you keep whatever. Whoop de boo. But this one guy just kept asking for weed every day, and I never had it for him. And I was like, man, let me pinch out. A little blunt, you know, I'm gonna have it over here. So when this guy asks me, whatever. So, of course, as soon as I do that, we're in class. I'm like, next period, I'm gonna give it to him and he'll get his blunt satisfied. And then they said, hey, Josh, could you come? This is, you know, in the middle of class. I'm like, yeah, what's going on? And I'm such a popular guy in school. I'm like, what the fuck do you want? He's an assistant principal. But I'm like, fuck you. What's good? I'm me. He's like, come this way. And he's not saying nothing. You know, I'm like, oh, fuck. I try to walk behind him so I can, like, take the thing out of my big ass suit and just throw it. And he's like, no. You go ahead. I'm like, I'm fucked. And then I get in the office, and they're like, empty out your pockets. I should have kept it in my back pocket. They wouldn't have checked. But I took it out of panic. Had number 5 written on it because I was saying it was a nickel. And then the rest was so they got me out of there. Then I had to go to a fucking private Montessori school or some shit. It was weird. Then ended up still getting a basketball scholarship to a school in East Tennessee, though, somehow. Okay. So
All's well that ends well.
Well, yeah, that left, dropped out of there too. But, you know, we're here now.
There we go.
You know what I mean?
There's a lot of weed jokes you can come up with then.
Oh, my God. Yeah.
All that and stuff.
Oh, because I wasn't even smoking then. And then I found weed in college, and it was over. It's crazy. Like, that's all I did. Like, I found weed. I stopped playing basketball. I'm like, why not smoke? And then opened up a third eye, and I'm like, oh, you know, whoop-de-woo. It's crazy. Then I went to, like, I went to MTSU after that. Did nothing but smoke weed. Then I went to Nashville State, and then I smoked weed and stole. I found out a hustle. Like, I would steal the books, like, textbooks.
Textbooks.
And, you know, they were, like, fucking $400.
Yeah, they were.
So I was stealing from the gift shop in the middle of the night, and then either sell them back to the gift shop or sell them to students. And I was making probably $2,000 every like a week. So I'm like, oh, fuck school.
I'll stay in school for 10 years.
Yeah, but after a while, they ran out of – it was a small school. They ran out of books, you know what I mean? And it was a mess. So I started going to MTSU and doing it, and then that got a little messy. But
Then on the Barnes & Nobles. And I got a book thing.
I say all that to say after stealing so many, I started reading a few. And then I started loving reading a lot. So I just stopped stealing and started reading. Well, I still kept stealing, but I wasn't selling them. I would go to Barnes & Noble on West End. This was a while ago, so they can't get me. Yeah. I would just go out, and then I rip the barcode out, and then walk out the other door. And so I have a hell of books in my house still. Of like, it's probably 100 books with no barcode.
Yeah.
Like, so I would just read them, and it would just be so, and I would learn so much. And then I started rapping, and then boom, there you go.
There you go.
Yeah, beautiful. Read, kids.
Yeah.
Read. And steal.
That's a good place to stop.
I think
we're
good.
Yeah.
Thanks, sir.
Thank y'all
Joshua.
So much for having
me. Thanks for coming down.
This was
great.
Excellent. Yeah, we got to do this again.
Yeah, we got to go to the gift shop and find you some Papa Willie's or Nashville stuff.
It's going to be excellent. Peace.
Yes.
This is beautiful.
Sir Joshua Black is my favorite comedian.
He's a great guy. Great interview. Had a good time.
We're supposed to have drinks with him.
Yes. And if you're in Nashville, you got to go check him out down at Zanies.
Yeah, and check out his videos because they're super funny.
Yep. So anyway, we'll see you next week with another fantastic comedian.
Enjoy your groceries.
I know your mama's name.
Free Britney and don't be an asshole.